Again, good afternoon. This is week two of this Foundations of the American Republic. And this week is America. Is it a democracy? Is it a republic? That seems to be a question that never seems to be answered here. I don't know if it's the education system. I don't know if it's we don't spend enough time with our government itself, or whatever the answer is here. It seems that many of our fellow citizens struggle with that one. I mean, how many times have you ever heard this thing about democracy, right? Well, who was the last president we had? Hasn't been out of office all that long. Wasn't he supposed to be a constitutional lawyer? And what did he constantly refer to us as? Democracy, 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 democracy. I mean, again, my favorite show is The Honeymooners. I always remember Ed Norton working in that sewer. You know, Ralph, some days I've had it right up the hair. I mean, we are not a democracy. We were founded as a republic. All you need do is the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the democracy for which it stands. Wouldn't they change that? And all you need to do, too, is, and I urge you to do this, read the Constitution and its attendant Bill of Rights. The word democracy is not doesn't register once. Doesn't exist in those documents. Doesn't exist. And when you go through the Constitution, you know, all new states will have what? Republican form of government. It's not spelled D-E-M-O-C-R-A-C-Y. It's republic. And if you read the missives and the letters and get into the debates in the Constitutional Convention, the founders were not fans of democracy. They really weren't. They thought it was a tyranny of the majority over the minority. That's what they thought the potential could lead to here. And so they came up with something known as a republic, with its checks and balances and so on and so forth. You know, of course, that leads to the question, well, what's the difference between a democracy and a republic? Isn't that what this eventually leads to? Yeah, of course it does. Well, you basically have two types of democracies, don't you? Participatory and representative, right? Participatory. Well, that's when the people themselves, you know, your local town meetings, perhaps, in some like throughout New England here. Yeah, is that a form of democracy, a participatory democracy? But you know, if someone doesn't like what's stated, you do have recourse in your state constitution. Ah, now it's not like England. England doesn't have a written constitution. Sure, they've had documents through the centuries, but they don't have a specific constitution to guide their government. When did they do that? They didn't. They didn't. So with a participatory democracy, it's interesting. I saw one of these in action Africa is interesting. Even in some of the backwaters, some of these hamlets, you have a form of participatory democracy. Take, for instance, you know, you got this little hamlet, this little village. And let's say the agenda on the agenda of the day, let's say it's a Saturday, right? The agenda is, well, do we spend the money to replace the irrigation system, or do we spend the money for a brand new irrigation system? And so you might have a microphone set up in the village square, and everyone gets up. You know, you've been to common council meetings. Don't you get your customary 3 minutes? And how many people usually talk, unless it's a very important agenda? There's not very many people that get up and talk. Well, if you've got about 100 or 150 people here waiting, and they're talking more than 3 minutes, guess what you're doing here? But everyone gets a chance to air their views. Yes, I think we need a new irrigation system. No, I don't think we need a new irrigation. It costs too much. Let's just fix the one we have. And then the village elders might vote. Maybe there's 15 village elders. Obviously here, if it's 8-7 in favor of just fixing the current irrigation system, guess what happens here? That's what's going to happen. There's no recourse. The 51-49 rule applies. And so here you see participatory democracy in action. How about representative democracy? Well, England comes to mind here, right? House of Commons, Parliament? That come to mind here? Yeah. fought again. And these people elect their representatives to parliament. And so what happens here? Well, a certain topic comes up and they vote on it, and it's the 5149 rule. But where's the recourse? Is there a written constitution that says, well, this violates the Seventh Amendment? That doesn't exist. Yet you know what's interesting here? After the Second World War, the House of Lords, you know, they passed a law in England in 1948-49 that if push came to shove, House of Commons won't exist. Any decisions made here? Persona non grata. Would you like to live in a country like that? I don't know if I would. Yet here, you have what's known as a republic, where you elect representatives to the state, to Washington, to represent your views. And again, you know, when you get into this, from the very beginning here, you could elect your two-year representative. That we've had since the beginning. Senators, you couldn't elect those. You couldn't elect them until 1913. Senators, six-year senators, were appointed by the state legislators. That's in the Constitution, by the way. President? Well, yeah, you could popular vote, but what else did they have? Yeah. Which that term really doesn't come into vogue until 1845. I'm not going to get deep into that now because I'm going to ruin next week. In the Constitution, they're known as electors.
Was it more usable in the century 2000?
Well, we'll see about that. We'll see about that. And so what you see here, yes, and you're going to have a chief executive, the president, a judiciary, which you don't elect. Aren't they appointed? Yes, ultimately Supreme Court. And then you have Congress, House of Representatives, and a Senate. Of course, back then, again, you didn't elect your senators. They were appointed by state legislators. But your House, yes. Interesting, the constitutional debates, when they were discussing all this, there was the one House. Well, you know, some said, well, what happens if you have a strong individual who takes over and runs that one House? You have a chief executive, you have your judiciary, which you don't elect, and then you have a strong individual in the legislative branch. How's that going to work? No, we need two houses. In other words, another check or balance. Of course, when you go through the 19th century and America's coming on as an industrial power, you began to see these the popular term robber barons trying to make sure certain people were appointed to positions in state legislatures that would appoint people to the Senate. So in 1913, you're going to have, well, let's just have the public vote for senators. And that's what they're going to do after 1913. Of course, you know, that's the year, too, the Federal Reserve comes into vogue here. So they threw you a bone, but then took away something else, maybe. That's another discussion. But you see that we are a republic. We are not a democracy. But that term has been bandied about, I mean, all through my lifetime. Go back even to World War II. What were we called? The arsenal of democracy? What happened to the term republic here, arsenal of republic? That doesn't sound all that great. You know, it sells more newspapers, arsenal of democracy. Go back to the First World War. This war was supposed to be fought for democracy. That's what Woodrow Wilson said. And this idea of spreading democracy or fighting for democracy, Franklin D. Roosevelt picked up on that. Jimmy Carter picked up on that. George Bush picked up on that. I'm talking junior for Iraq. We're going there to bring democracy. You know, to me, this isn't hard to figure out. If we were founded as a republic, what gives us the right to go to Iraq and bring a form of government, which, in essence, we really don't practice ourselves? Who gave us the right to do that? I don't think we sit down and really think those things out. It's the same thing with initiatives and referendums. You folks have voted for those when around election time, right? Occasionally, initiatives, referendums, right? That smacks of democracy. The founders wouldn't have liked that. You elect representatives to represent your interests in Washington. What are you initiatives for? If you don't like what they're doing, vote them out. Simple. But in the end, no system of government is going to work unless what? The people take part? I mean, what happened after the mid-1970s here? Interesting what you saw develop here after the 1970s. I mean, I don't have to go into the 1960s here for some of you. You lived that era. The Vietnam War, right? What happened with the protests in the streets? And you had the civil rights movement at the same time. You had people in college, academics and students, questioning America's state religion, capitalism. That's what they were doing. And then what follows? The Lewis Powell memo in August 1971. And if you fast forward through the decades till now, you see the advent of the corporate state. So America is neither a republic or a democracy, it's a corporate state. That's what we've become. But again, when you go back to, you know, the founding of the country here, it's fascinating. This idea of having a republic instead of a democracy. The founders consulted history. Greece, the Roman Republic. But they thought democracy is interesting. Democracy will not last. Why? Because you can't trust the people. They're turbulent. And they don't determine right. Boy, does that sound like Alexander Hamilton? If you said yes, you'd be right. Of course, Alexander Hamilton is the one that stated, that much power needs to go to the rich and the well-born.
But everybody agreed with him. Let's not.
Well, some people did, some people didn't. Because if you take somebody like a John Adams, who stated, for a bona fide system of representative government to work, the wide ownership of property is desired. Now keep in mind, when the country was first formed, who voted? People with property?
Men.
Men? Okay, men. Is that at odds with a
rich white men?
Well, yeah, but is that at odds with a bona fide system of representative government? One would think. But keep in mind, they're making this up as they go along here. Keep in mind. However, getting back to John Adams, if a system of wide ownership of property is conducive to a bona fide system of representative government, then look at your history, going from the 18th into the 19th century. And what do you see here? It's one of the reasons for the American Revolution. Because the crown stopped people from grabbing land. Free land. Oh, check that, free land. Indian land. You know, if you had poor whites living in a village, a hamlet, a town, not very many cities in America at this point, and you're looking to make a go of it, okay, let's pick up the family and move 50 miles west. We'll grab some free land. Someone else does the same thing. Someone moves next to them. Another family moves next to them. And what does it become? Territory, right? What does it eventually become?
A state.
Is that how we spread? Yeah, it is. In other words, what I'm telling you here is we are unique in this way. You know, the British, the French, and the Spanish came here. They stick a flag on it, put troops. This belongs to the crown. That's not our version of colonialism. Our version of colonialism was you spreading across this land, grabbing territory. The banks and big business didn't do that. The people did. The railroads are going to follow. The telegraph are going to follow. The bankers are going to follow until Chesapeake Bay is linked with the Golden Gate. The people do this. Wide ownership of land. Yeah, there were problems with that one too. You know, is the so-called privilege try to grab land? Are there conflicts involved? And of course there are. Of course there are. But we still had some sort of a republic. However, when you get to the Spanish-American War, it all changes. Why? Well, Chesapeake Bay is linked with the Golden Gate. And so we get involved with that war with the Spanish, and we grab Puerto Rico. Cuba becomes a free nation, if you believe that one. We grab the Philippines and Guam. Now, Ma and Pa Kettle aren't grabbing that land. Now it's the Army and Navy. Manifest Destiny, which was based in part on people getting land across this great, across this wide expanse, now has given way to the Army and the Navy. Does that undermine what you have, a so-called republic? Yes. Again, part of what we call a republic was based on the fact that we would have a large, small standing army. And I'm not going to get into this too deep because I'm going to go into well-regulated militia in 2 weeks. But the basis of this was the governors controlled the military for the most part, the citizen-soldier concept. Yet when you get to the Spanish-American War, that changes, and power is gravitating toward the center. Now, if you read your Constitution and Bill of Rights, you find that the rights of the individual are enshrined here. The rights of the individual are enshrined here. Again, you know, when you have votes taken in Congress, let's say you don't like it. Let's say, well, gee whiz, I'm reading this, and this violates, I don't know, let's say the Seventh Amendment. You get on the phone or email, hey, Jim, meaning Himes here, hey, this violates the Seventh Amendment, you change it. You never know, maybe he's thinking along the same lines. Well, you know, yeah, I was talking to another congressman and we feel the same way. Okay, then maybe there's a chance to change that legislation or change that resolution. You have recourse with your Constitution. That's not happening in Britain. They're done. Here, there's the possibility. You have access because of your Constitution. It's interesting how we don't really, it seems like we've lost touch with that. The other side of the coin here is your Constitution was your blueprint for government. That was our blueprint for government with its attendant Bill of Rights. So, and for limited government, that's what this was. Of course, the country only had 2,500,000 people in 1787, 1790. That's all it had. Now you have a country of what? 360, 330, there's a lot of people. It's a lot of people. And yet at the same time, your Bill of Rights was supposed to be, the attendant Bill of Rights was your protection against the infringement of government. Which is why when you have a president that says, I'm going to bring back waterboarding or worse, he's violating the Eighth Amendment. Cruel and unusual punishment? What happened to the Constitution here? You know... He's never read it. Well, maybe so. Maybe not recently. But the fact of the matter is here, you know, you go back and you take a look at your Constitution then, take a look at it now. Does it need to be updated? Now, there's a discussion for you. Are there a lot more people in the country? Yes, of course there are. Does that mean there's going to be a lot more different opinions, desires, and wants? You know there will be. And in a letter in 1816 to Samuel Kershaval, Thomas Jefferson stated that maybe after 19 or 20 years, virtually the people who are in office need to be swept out. We need to put this in the Constitution. What he's implying here without saying it directly is perhaps we should have a constitutional convention every generation. Have we done that? Not really. You know, not being stupid, he understood that the country in 1787 was not going to be the same country in 1857. Not hard to figure that one out.
Scalia had trouble figuring that out.
Well, but then again, you know, so you see how maybe the document hasn't really kept up, or the people's use of the document hasn't kept up to where we are now. Interesting what you see here. And then fast forward after the Spanish-American War, after America becomes a big power on the world stage. Go to what you call the First World War. 1917, what happens? You know, April 6, 1917 is a decisive day in the history of this country. It changed the country. Why? because Congress codifies the fact we are now a global power. Again, go back to the Spanish-American War. We're taking our place on the world stage. Teddy Roosevelt sends the Great White Fleet around the world, announcing to the world that we're a global power. Any country that buys and builds a larger navy is telling the world we're now ready to spread influence outside our borders. The Royal Navy come to mind here? How about the Imperial Japanese Navy? How about the Germans attempt World War I, World War II? The Soviets with their Blue Water Navy after the Second World War. And what's China doing right now?
Building cars.
Missiles.
Buying and building a larger navy, right? Well, what does that tell you? They're looking to expand and extend influence outside their borders. And India's doing the same sort of thing, you know. Interesting what you see develop here. But getting to the point here is, you know, in this thing we call the First World War, which to me is a European Civil War, that's what that was. It draws in countries from outside Europe, but it's a European Civil War. It's fought for European issues. But once we're in this conflict, what happens? The War Industries Board, to me, this is a poster child expression of the undermining of the Constitution. Why? Because instead of having businesses saying, well, we're going to produce such and such products, and we're going to ship them out such and such a date, and we're going to make such and such a money, no! Corporations cease doing that. You have one person running the American economy as far as production goes. His name is Bernard Baruch. It's called the War Industries Board. Everything now is going to be planned. It's going to be planned. You'll produce such a thing for the war effort. You'll produce something else. You will produce this. You will produce that. There are quotas and schedules, shipping schedules. Everything's got to be delivered at such and such a time. However, when you get into a conflict like this, that's what has to be done. And it's instances like this that have helped to undermine our Constitution. Because you're taking your place on the world stage and you're beginning to build an empire. Pax Americana is coming. That's coming. Mr. Washington warned about this in his farewell address. Beware of entangling alliances. Remember that one? He wasn't concerned with business deals or embassies. That's not the issue. The issue here is, in our republic, it's in our Constitution. Isn't the president supposed to go before Congress and ask for a declaration of war? Who was the last one to do that? Franklin D. Roosevelt, right. Harry Truman didn't do that.
Didn't George Bush, the 41st,
didn't do that? No. No.
No. Didn't recognize it as a war, right? Because it was
correct.
A police
correct. As same terminology they used in Korea. That terminology was also used for Vietnam. In fact, this is where you get into, again, go back to what Mr. Washington will talk about. Beware of entangling alliances. And the reason he wrote that is because of the fact that perhaps if we have it in the country in question then, I'm talking then, you know, the 1790s, is France. They're undergoing the revolution at this point, and the French Revolutionary Army is fighting the monarchs of Europe. The French Revolutionary War. And so did they want us to help them? Of course they did. However, if you sign a military alliance, doesn't that obligate you to answer the call if your alliance partner needs help? Well, how is that going to work if the president goes before Congress and asks for the declaration of war, and he's got dozens of congressmen and senators and saying, well, my constituents aren't going to like that, and we're not going to give you that declaration of war. What happened to your credibility on the international stage? That's it, you don't have any. And so this idea of joining alliances was an anathema to George Washington. I just gave a talk last Saturday on the Newburgh incident. That is a fascinating episode. The potential of the Continental Army to revolt. And George Washington put it down. March 15, 1783. the officers. There were uprisings, you know, in 1780, 1782. The common everyday soldiers, you know, the Continental Congress promised to pay these guys, promised to give them food, promised to give them new uniforms. Interesting, the British Army, who lose this war, in their resplendent red, white uniforms, and some of the Continental soldiers in rags. In fact, in 1782, 1783, in some of these units, Continental Army, some of these regiments, you might have one coat for every six guys. Try doing that in December. So yeah, you had some revolts. In fact, a Pennsylvania regiment will revolt in January 1782, and it will have to be put down, and George Washington will tell them, pick four of your ringleaders. They pick four, he has two of them shot. That's a Stalinist approach. Does it work? Yeah.
The Connecticut line revolted as well.
Yes, they did. In fact, I think it was in 1782, they were ready to march on Hartford, a Connecticut regiment up the line here.
And that ironically, it was the Pennsylvania regiments that put down the Connecticut line mutiny. And
yes.
The Connecticut line that put down the Pennsylvania mutiny.
And there was a New Jersey unit that revolted too. In fact, New Jersey was going to march on the Continental Congress. And so one of those Pennsylvania regiments was too. So it wasn't, America wasn't hunky-dory here at this point. But then again, you see, once they form the country in this republic, the idea is to have a small standing army. And of course, what happens when you get into the 20th century? Now that you're fighting these large wars, the citizen-soldier concept goes out the window. Now you need a professional army. That leads to eventually a what? A military-industrial complex. To the point now, as of last August, the Army can't find $6.5 trillion. Now again, how your government is supposed to work, Congress, you know, your firewall here, you know, put forth the 1990 Act called the Chief Financial Officers Act. Every branch of the federal government was supposed to do an audit. Guess who hasn't done that audit in 26 years? Anyone want to take a guess?
The military.
Department of Defense. And so when you look at what Mr. Washington stated in his farewell address, and then fast forward to what Mr. Eisenhower said in his farewell address, put the two to two together, and then you find the Army, there was a major, I believe, a bean counter in the Pentagon who came out with this in August of last year. The Army can't account for $6.5 trillion. Not billion, not million, $6.5 trillion. I don't know if that guy will ever make colonel. But the fact of the matter is, Rumsfeld alluded to a $2.8 trillion shortfall back in 2001, 2002. But again, if there is no accountability and a functioning system of representative government has accountability. So what I'm telling you here is, since we don't seem to abide by the Constitution as much anymore, I mean, go back here. You know, freedom of religion, that's fine. Free speech, that's fine. Freedom of the press. What did Bill Clinton do when he savaged the FCC? We now have six owners of most of the media in this country. That's not free press. No matter what they tell you, it's not free press. It's not. And so when you see continued marginalizations or attacks on the Constitution, if the Constitution was supposed to be your blueprint for your government, and we're not using the Constitution like we should be using it, what does that lead you to think? That politically we're a failed state. We are. We're a failed state. And that void has been filled by who? America's royalty. Again, go back to the Lewis Powell memo when Lewis Powell, who later be nominated to the Supreme Court by Richard Nixon, addressed the Lewis Powell memo, which I call the Manifesto of American Fascism, to the Chamber of Commerce. Big business and the banks need to take more interest in the education system, need to take more interest in the communication system, And he railed against one individual in particular who was undermining the edifice of American capitalism, Ralph Nader. Ralph Nader. Interesting what you see develop here. Yes?
You know, basically, if you go back to the founding of our country, in terms of democracy, when you really want to get it down to its finest point, it's a state of mind. It basically is saying to the common, everyday person, you're a citizen, and you live in this country that has the illusion of a democracy, which in reality is getting less and less and less with each passing moment. And when you really understand the history of our country, no one in their right mind would have believed that the semantics of 200 and some odd years ago would still have validity today. But yet it's like a security blanket when people say, well, I know I live in a republic, but it's also a democracy, because it elevates you as a person. And so it's more of a concept of emotion rather than really anything else.
Well, in that handout, when I broke down democracy, republic, fascism, Marxism, socialism, so on and so forth, the end of this, where I ended with regards to republic, the generally accepted version of republic is, and I blacken this out, rule by law. Now, go over to fascism. The poster child expression here was Mussolini's Italy after 1922. Fascism contains the elements of nationalism, syndicalism, socialism, idealism, which is the importance of goals, principles, values, and also includes the penchant, and this might ring a bell right now with what's going on, includes the penchant to see things as they might be, as opposed to seeing things as they are. Fascism largely hinges on the idea of the primacy of the state, obedience, discipline. These factors will determine their cultural, societal, political, and moral philosophies. The state manages a firm grip on all endeavors. Fascism can be authoritarian or totalitarian. If you take a look at Mussolini's fascist Italy, how was that government erected? The major corporations ran their industries, overseen by a dictator by the name of Benito Mussolini.
So doesn't it really come down to who governs?
Or who wants to govern,
yeah,
perhaps. But here you see the modern corporate state. It's a fascist corporate state. And yet what's happening here in this country at this almost the same time? Go back to the First World War. I mentioned it before. Bernard Baruch and the War Industries Board. This will be followed in 1929-1930, you know, when the Depression hits. Gerald Swope, president of GE, the Swope plan, organizing the economy to get us out of the Depression, overseen, guess by who? Big corporations. And who is going to gravitate to this when he's elected president in 1933? Franklin D. Roosevelt, the NRA, the National Recovery Act. If you read the National Recovery Act, that is a blueprint for a corporate socialist state. That's what it is. Interesting what just, and I always get a kick out of my, in fact, I'm kind of the middle of the road, so I have my liberal friends and I have my really conservative friends. But then, you know, my real liberal, oh, you know, some of my liberal friends will say, well, Roosevelt was a liberal. He wasn't a liberal, he's a banker. Eleanor was the liberal. By the way, I'm going to give that talk on her at the beginning of the next month. Eleanor Roosevelt. Boy, is she a fascinating character. I'd like to see her take if she was around now. Yes?
I would argue that what Roosevelt did was bring Hamilton's vision into the 20th century.
That's correct.
Saying that the government will fix things.
You know, bouncing off what you just stated, and it's interesting here what you're seeing. At the same time, you are seeing, you know, Mr. Roosevelt and his crew did everything they could to get this country out of a depression. You know, that alphabet soup of different programs that they had? I'm sure maybe there's a couple of people here maybe who were old enough to remember that as kids. I know my father-in-law still is. Drives my wife nuts. My father-in-law is 94, he's gonna be 94, and he still saves nails. And some of the, he's got these jars, and he saves these nails. Some of them are good nails, and I gotta give the guy credit. And some, but some of them have rust on them, even though they're straight. Drives me, gee, why doesn't he throw them out? I said, Rosemary, cut him a break. This is a guy that lived in the Depression. You saved stuff. You didn't get rid of it. You saved it. You know, when your father's not able to walk around as much anymore, then we'll get rid of the stuff. But, you know, out of respect, why throw it out? You know? But going back to what you're saying, yes, but what's going to get us out of the war in the end? Or out of the Depression in the end? Right. And how did we do that? Military production. And another man figures this out. And some of you have heard me say this in other talks. Joseph Stalin, another corporatist. Why? Go back to 1927-28. What does Joe Stalin see? He understands, like Mr. Roosevelt will later understand, and like Mr. Churchill will later understand. You think it's an accident these guys are going to be the big three after 41? No, it's not. That Versailles is the biggest hoax ever perpetrated on modern man. And there's another war coming. So what does Joe Stalin do? That's it, he industrialized. We're going to collectivize the peasant. We're going to pinch some of his grain and livestock. We're going to sell it on the world market, generate hard currency, and build this factory system. And he'll bring in American, British, and French engineers to do it. And he's going to focus on heavy industry. Guess what we're going to do in the Second World War? Focus on heavy industry. And so by 1941, the Soviet Union is arguably the world's second largest industrial power. Why? Because Joe Stalin got away from that proletarian revolution stuff. You think you're going to be a world power doing that? No, you will be if you industrialize. And that's what he's going to do. This is Joe Stalin Incorporated. And so what happens here? It's the two countries that, it's interesting. One supposedly free, America's not free market, but it's more of a capitalist nation, yet Stalin goes with state capitalism. They're the two countries that are going to win this war in the end by 45. The two, number one and number two industrial powers will win this war. Yet, are they really what you want to call them, democracies? No. And what's happening to our republic? It's being undermined. More and more central control leaches into the system. You need that to win a war like this. Again, go back to what George Washington stated. We don't want untimely alliances. We don't want a large standing army. Yes?
So as much of a problem as Survivor Rook and his coordinated war production may have been.
But was it necessary?
It was necessary.
Okay.
As much of a problem as it may have caused us in the long term, the absence of that in a more modern context shows during the wars, in the most recent wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, when we had no coordinated war production, we did not even have enough bullets for our own troops to shoot, and you only had one company in America that was capable of producing the up-armored and redesigned Humvees to save American troops from the improvised explosive devices. So you have now a modern military with no coordinated production to protect the soldiers.
Yeah, but you know what's happened here too? Again, undermining of our governmental system. You know, when you have what you call World War II, when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, right? what did many young American guys do? Went down to the recruiting offices, right? Yeah, if you go to the it's interesting. You know, December 8, 1941, I'm sure Roosevelt's not even done making his pitch for that declaration of war, which you don't think he's not gonna get, you know. I mean, the lines in some of the recruiting offices were out the door, down the street, and around the corner. If you go to the VA, they'll tell you. The VA will tell you that 16,112,000 Americans put on a uniform by September 2nd, 1945. That was 12.2% of then the population of the United States, approximately 132 million people. But if you weren't in a uniform or you got rejected, what were you doing? Working in a war plant, right? How about women?
Yeah.
Rosie the Riveter here? Everyone was part of the system. Everyone was in it. Hell, when you can get 6-7-year-old kids with their little red wagons hauling scrap and pots and pans down to a collection center, boy, you got a war effort going. Of course, I guess the question now is today, how many 6-7-year-old kids have little red wagons? But the fact of the matter is, everyone was on the same page. You know why? I was giving a talk one night at night at Fairfield Library. It was about Vietnam, and I got into Korea too. And I didn't know this. There was a guy sitting in the back, an elderly gentleman. He came up to me when I was all over. He said he enjoyed the talk, but he was part of the Truman administration. And I didn't know that. And he says, back in my day, people trusted government. How many people trust their government today? Back in World War II, you did. And so, but anyway, hold that question though. But here you see people coming together. Why? Let's get this over with and get on with our lives. But what's happened since?
They stopped teaching civics.
Well, that's part of it. But you see in Korea, again, someone mentioned it before. The terminology we used before.
Police action,
right. You know, that goes back to the world, just before World War II.
But it's different also. Korea did not attack the United States.
Correct.
So it's like 9/11, which brought everybody together
right.
for 20 or 30 minutes, right? Well, it did. But, I mean, Japan attacked the United States. That was different. That's why guys went and put on their uniforms. That's not what Korea or Vietnam was.
No, because the world has changed here.
That's right.
The world has changed. Korea was that experiment by getting around the Constitution because we are affiliated with the United Nations, known as collective security. That term they used in the early 30s, which didn't work with the League of Nations. And so perhaps Korea is one of the finest hours of the United Nations, where countries got together to throw out what they called an aggressor. Of course, that was a civil war anyway. It starts in Korea.
But even if Korea had been called a war, it wouldn't mobilize people the same way because I don't think people saw that as a threat to the United States, did they? It's not the same.
Well, back then, in fact, in the beginning of the Vietnam War, my daddy stopped Nazism, I'm gonna go stop communism. Yet what they don't understand is people like Ho Chi Minh is more of a revolutionary nationalist than a communist. He had no intention of invading the Dutch East Indies. He was looking to unite his country after he was given the gate at Versailles in 1919, believing in Woodrow Wilson's 14 points. And so you see this cross here, communism, revolutionary nationalism. However, as Vietnam goes on, what's happening here? People are becoming more and more disenchanted.
Yeah.
To the point now, where you're not even part of the agenda anymore. In 1941, you were. Now you're not. I worked with a colonel up at Army Aviation magazine. The guy flew Apache attack helicopters for 20 years. Was in the Persian Gulf War. And Colonel Ford told me, I remember we used to have these discussions every so often. And I remember him telling me, right to my face, today's wars are not for patriotism, they're for national interest. Yes?
The Pentagon Papers changed everything. It laid out how the government lied to the electorate.
Oh, yeah, I know. I printed out all that stuff and put it in my files. In fact, you know, so, but getting back to what you're alluding to here, yes, do people trust their government anymore? Of course not. In fact, it's to the point that you're so ostracized from your foreign policy that after 9/11, again, remember what I said about World War II, the VA. 16,112,000 Americans putting on a uniform, 12.2% of the population. And yet, after 9/11, 2,850,000 put on a uniform to go fight in Iraq and Afghanistan. That's 0.8% of the American population. What happened? What happened? And so you see here, again, this idea, I mentioned it before, this thing known as our Constitution and Bill of Rights. They were our blueprint for limited government. Now, obviously, here, as the country grows, should we have those constitutional conventions to make the document coincide with the country? Maybe we would have become a democracy in this essence instead of a republic. But that hasn't happened. And so what's happened here? Leaving your constitution and becoming what you are now, which is really a corporate state. Are we politically a failed state? Yes. You go through the motions of voting, but really what determines it in the end? Money. Citizens United ring a bell here? Yes.
No, there's no more draft.
You don't.
Have a volunteer army now.
Yeah, but you have a backdoor draft. They're called private contractors. That's your backdoor draft. It is. If you don't get enough guys to show up or enough ladies to show up, we'll hire it done.
Yeah, but it comes down to money again.
Of course, and you're going to pay 4, 5, 6 times per soldier as you would. And I talked to my kid when he was in Iraq. Hey there, did you meet any of those Blackwater guys? Yeah, I met them. They get paid 4, 5, 6 times to do the same thing I'm doing. I said, yeah, the big difference is you're allied to a flag, they're allied to a check. I mean, if that's the way you want to run your foreign policy. But keep in mind, you go back in history, what happened to the Assyrian Empire when people got fed up with fighting? They hired it done. What happened to that empire? What happened to Rome?
Same thing.
Yeah, same thing. The Romans were hiring the German tribes they were fighting. How long do you think that's going to last? Look at the Ottoman Empire. After fighting the Safavid Persians for 100 years, they undermined the Ottoman Empire. By 1918, after the First World War, it's gone. This is what happens when a nation fights too long. Hint, 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 hint. I get a kick out of that. Gee whiz, you know, this Afghanistan's America's longest running war. How many times you read that in the newspaper? Didn't these reporters ever understand? What happened with the Seminoles? How long did that war last? Longer than the Afghan war, for 20 years. It's amazing what we don't get here. It's amazing what we don't get. It's fascinating. Absolutely fascinating. Yeah, yes?
But we really don't want to get it either. Because if we really wanted to get it, it would scare us witless. More scared than we probably are.
I just sound like my wife. This is frightening. Are you kidding? This is exciting.
It is exciting, but the fright and excitement are parts of the same coin.
Yeah, you know, when you go back, you don't have to go back that far if you look at what happened to Weimar Germany. You were in that class I did,
yes.
the Nazi Revolution,
yes.
1919, 1934. You see commonalities here. You know, this, although there are differences, our republic was formed from the ground up. The German Republic was formed because of what? A loss in a war. You know, the Hohenzollern family, they're gone. Well, let's try a republic, the Weimar Republic. Remember that? Yeah, the Weimar Republic. Number one, if the British and the French were really enamored with keeping peace in Europe, they would have supported this. They don't. However, you're asking a bunch of people who have come out of an authoritarian style of government, the Kaiser, who will not see the end of the war, by the way. Yeah, he's in office in 1918. But who do you think's running Germany by 1916? The German High Command. And then when they lose the war, you know, the Allies really didn't make a real concerted effort to get rid of the German general staff. So people like Hans von Siegt, who wanted to rearm Germany, they changed the name. Well, we won't call it the German General Staff anymore. We'll call it the Troop Office. Sounds innocuous, doesn't it? The Troop Office. And yet, what you see with the German Republic, yeah, they're going to have the Reichstag, they're going to elect their officials, but because the economy is shattered, and because of the, you know, they lost this war, the German army is looking to rearm. and rebuild despite the Nazis. The Nazis really don't have any have any input here. They're not even a bona fide entity at this point. But the German army was going to rearm anyway. They wanted to undermine the Versailles Treaty. Germany wasn't supposed to have any more than 100,000 men in their army, 15,000 in their navy. No tanks, no aircraft, no poison gas, none of that stuff. Now what's going to happen by 1935, 36, 37? But the fact of the matter is, they're undermining this republic. You know, it began to bounce back in 1924 when we floated German bonds. Of course, 1929, what happens? Down it goes. But the fact of the matter is, as a coming military power, that undermines a republic. And as that republic is falling on hard times, 1929, 1930, 1931, the military wants to rebuild. In fact, they had already started by that point. And you have an opportunist by the name of Adolf Hitler. Will go with the bankers and the businessmen and the military, and they're off and running as a dictatorship. And so what you're seeing, and you begin to see people here in Germany becoming disenfranchised or becoming disappointed, not only disenfranchised from their government, disappointed with representative government. Now, fast forward to the United States. What's the approval rating of Congress here? South of 10%?
Yeah.
You know, somebody like a Miss Clinton or Mr. Trump doesn't bother me as much as many of my fellow citizens may be losing faith in representative government. Yes?
When I was in the military in the 1960s, I was being paid $65 a month. At $65 a month, you can afford to fight a war, but not if you're paying what Blackwater has to pay.
Well, that's part of it. That's part of it. But then again, if the Army can't find $6.5 trillion over the years, notice I said Army. I didn't say anything about the Navy or the Air Force. I said the Army. In fact, I talked about this up at Army. We've had conversations about this over Army Aviation. I remember my boss telling me, he goes, "Hey, you ready for the new president?" I said, "Well, you rub elbows with these high muckety mucks. Why don't you tell them to find that $6.5 trillion? Fat chance of that. Somebody says it's gone.
How much of that disappeared in Iraq?
When my son was in Iraq, the second time, 2008, in Ramadi, and they had a mission one night. And they had their Humvees, but they had a truck with all these bundles in it, and they had a meeting set up. With some of these tribal sheikhs. And, you know, they unload all the bundles. And Eric said, he says, "I was told, you know, we were all told to keep our mouths shut." And he says, "I find out later I'm really an overpaid Brinks guard is what I am." And they unload all these bundles, and then they get inside, and the meeting starts, and big bundle goes to this tribal sheikh, another big bundle goes to this one, and then down the line. And I said, "Yeah." I said, "They're paying off those awakening groups $10 a day not to shoot at your kids. That's what they were doing." And my son says to me, "I had to go to the poorest city in the world to see the most American money I'm ever going to see in my lifetime." What's wrong with this picture? That's part of the money. Where'd it go? And he says to me, he goes, "It's too bad there weren't 10 or 12 taxpayers here to watch this." I said, "If that was, they never would have got out of Iraq alive." Interesting what you see here. Fascinating. Is that a lack of oversight? One could make reference to that.
Or is it policy?
Or is it policy? But then again, is that a lack of oversight? So you see what's happened here from the time the country was founded. I mean, do you have a functioning republic anymore? No, you don't. You don't. End of discussion. You don't.
How? But in the beginning, the people weren't electing. I mean, the people as a whole weren't electing the representatives either. And we are, have we really changed since the beginning, I guess, is what I'm saying.
Well, people are people in the long run, that's true.
But people have more say, more people have did at the beginning, don't they? Because people can vote, people can, you know, protest, people can do, and not as large a percentage of the people could have the right to vote back then, right?
You know, it's interesting you bring that up, because when you go back to the 1876 election, which...
That's not the beginning.
No. You go back to the 1876 election, and that was one of those elections decided by the Electoral College. That was Rutherford B. Hayes against Samuel J. Tilden. And at one point, Tilden had 184 electoral votes, need 185. And Rutherford B. Hayes had 165. And so three states in particular down south, it was Louisiana, Georgia, South Carolina. Each of those states, each party, Democrat, Republican, claimed that their candidate had won. So it was supposed to go to the House of Representatives. Well, there's a compromise struck here, the Northerners and the Southerners. But the point of the fact of the matter is Rutherford B. Hayes will win. He'll get the 20 electoral votes and Tilden will lose. And they'll pull federal troops out of the South. But the fact of the matter is 81.2% of the American population voted. Yeah. And so what you're seeing here as you go along from the founding of the country, yes, are there commonalities between what happened then and now? You know, people voting and getting what they want out of the vote? Yeah, but you had a more patriotic outlook because it's new. And you see this develop here. Although keep in mind here, as the country's being formed, are there differences between the North and the South?
Yes.
Slavery being one. They kicked that can down the road. Why? Because they're looking to keep the country whole. We'll solve that problem later. It's really not until really the War of 1812 where patriotism really kicks in. You know why? Because we're invaded again. And it seems as soon as, in fact, if you go to some of the northern states run by Federalist governors, oh my God, the state militias, my guys aren't fighting outside their state borders. And some of these governors even withheld tax receipts for President Monroe. How are you going to fight a war this way? Or Madison, rather. How are you going to fight a war this way? However, when the British burned Washington, it seemed the number of people flocked to the banner here. And then when the war is over with, what's happened? Then the big exodus, let's move west. That had been going on anyway, but it seems that we don't want to be part of the world, we want to move west. And as they're moving west, you see this idea of setting up various local governments and get people getting involved in voting. It's huge. It's huge. Of course, maybe it's not so big anymore because we've grown up from that. No? And when you develop something new, where's your interest? It's in it. Yeah, it's in it. Yes?
Well, let's not forget, I mean, almost immediately after the Revolution, it was also dissatisfaction set again. You had Shays' Rebellion in Massachusetts.
The Whiskey Rebellion.
Which was a conflict between citizens of western Massachusetts on the west side of the Connecticut River and what was happening in their state legislature, and the Whiskey Rebellion, which had to do with taxation.
Right.
How it affected western Pennsylvania, where they really had no hard currency, and they did a lot of their trading in whiskey.
Right. Of course, that's the only time a sitting president got out of took off his suit, put on his military uniform again, and led the Pennsylvania State Militia.
And Thomas Paine turned against him and never let him forget it.
Right, but I think George Washington's the only president that ever did that. Interesting what you see here. Interesting what you see. Yes.
So what's really protecting us from truly being a fascist state?
There's only one protection, that's you.
Yeah,